in your face in the time taken by you to lift the razor to your face. So the amount of hair that grows in your face in the time taken for you to lift the razor to your face is known as a nanoparticle. How you can understand this thing? So now nano you are suffering. Thinking about nanoparticle itself is a very great danger to our thought. And nano devices, not only particles, nano robots, robots in the size of the nano. And I have already told you are going to come into, apart from nano technology, you are going to reach the other pico technology and frontier technology. It may come in future also. So how we are going to do with these things? So whenever a thing becomes the most lightest or subtlest, certainly there are two things. Lot of people, they will be afraid of big things. Lot of people, they will be liking big things. Something big in size. Something more colorful. See, each and everybody will have some taste. Taste for colorful things, taste of different things, taste for big things, taste for small things like that. You should have a nano desire inside your mind by which you can understand nanotechnology. Bio desire for biotechnology, info desire for info technology, cogno desire for cogno technology. These things are the real drivers by which you can reach the state itself. So something the shastras, they say that yes sukshmaha sottamaha, that which is sukshma is uttama. Likewise, nanoparticle also, they say that nanoparticle is light. As it is light to handle, it is also strong. As it is light and strong, it is also clean. Not only light, strong and clean, it is inexpressive. Not only light, strong, clean and inexpressive, it is also precise. So this type of particle is light, strong, inexpensive, clean, as well as precise in its functions, by which we are developing these things. And it is there everywhere. Nanotechnology is not only in medicine, nanophysics, nanochemistry, everywhere it is there. There are a lot of nanotoxicology is there. In molecular self-assembly, supramolecular self-assembly and self-assembled molecular layer or monolayer studies, and nanotechnology of DNA. DNA nanotechnology is there. Studying of DNA nanotechnology is there. This thing is in biology. And second thing is nanoelectronics has come. Nano circuitry is there. Nano lithography is there. Apart from which, nano ionics is there, like bionics, there is nano ionics, then molecular electronics, microelectronics, everything they have come into vogue. And by means of scanning tunneling, as well as atomic power, visualization of scanning probe models, we are seeing a lot of things in nanoparticles. So it should be driven by a desire to understand the existing, number one, three things, to understand the existing ones, number two, to continue with the existing ones, third, to create a destination whereby you achieve something, accomplish your individuality and your uniqueness. So you have to understand what you have been taught. Number two, you must understand how to carry on with your intuitive guidance. Number three, where is our destination? What we are going to intuitively design and we are going to develop to create our individuality or uniqueness. That is known as innovation. So these three things come from that nano desire. This cogno technology is the technology by which we are going to teach you how to develop this desire based on the inquisitive designs. And coming to this final bioinformatics, it is about understanding about the biological systems by means of information technology. Basically, you know that all the biological systems, they cannot be easily evaluated or they cannot be easily envisioned or equally structuralized. It requires some systems of data mining. It requires algorithms. It requires computational mechanics. It requires statistical studies. It requires simulation models. And it is required for finding, for viewing, for mapping, for comparing, for analytical studies, for everything we require some sort of modeling, which is by information technology alone. By means of this information technology alone, we are understanding three things. It is known as PSG. P is the protein, which is the basic energy level. And S is the sequence and structure. And G is the gene. So, bioinformatics can be very clearly, very precisely noted as PSG model. To understand about the structure and functional sequential order of proteins and genes of our structure. It is there in sequence analysis. Now there is a shotgun sequence analysis recently they have introduced. There is sequence analysis. And second thing is, it is having annotation, genomic annotation. Third thing is, it is very much used in computational evolutionary biology. It is there in understanding about biodiversity, in preservation of the DNA as well as the genomic material of the endangered species. It is there in biodiversity. It is there in understanding about the adaptation of or analytical study of mutation in cancers, understanding about regulations, understanding about genetic expression, protein expression, genal and protein exercises and structures. It is very much useful. It is useful in comparative genomics. It is useful in biological modeling, like human atlas, human map, life atlas, life structure, life module, life graph, everything we can understand to create new parts, to produce similar parts, to induce longevity in the existing part, to create an elixir, to extend your life, to repair the process, to create auto-receptivity and auto-repairability inside. Everything it is very much useful in this biological modeling system. Also, it is used in the high-level performance of throw-out imaging system which is existing now, which is known as biomedical imagery, which is in cytohistopathology, morphometrics and DNA mapping, etc. It is very much useful now, and it is used in protein-protein docking, and it is also going to be useful in the process of chemoinformatics. Now there is clinomics, there is proteomics, there is systemics, there is biocybernetics. Innumerable systems are emerging there, giving us lot of hope to learn. But these things are just frightening the people rather than brightening their standards of caliber. Whenever I say new subjects, immediately the people are frightened. Oh, this is one more headache which you have to take later. So this type of fear is created because of they have lost the taste buds of knowledge, recognition and relishment. There is a taste bud inside. Just as we are having tongue taste buds, there is a cognitive taste bud which makes the person to crave for more knowledge. No, I am dissatisfied. You teacher, teach me something more. The teacher should be afraid. Now also they are afraid in a different context. They should be afraid on seeing your extraordinary receptivity and craving for more knowledge. So these new dimensions, innumerable dimensions are also coming now. So to really conclude that, I want to say three things. There are some exercises which I have mentioned. In these exercises, very simply I want to say, one exercise I want to say very simply, whatever you want to know, you take a lesson that you have to only see, there must be three things. One is specification. Second is practice. Third thing is report or follow up. If it is not there, then there is no classroom or there is no lesson or there is no impact at all. Specification means I cannot teach a common lesson. Somebody may be having a trouble in somewhere, somebody will be having some sort of joy there, somebody will be having a double trouble in the same place. So it is different. So you select a lesson. This is specification. Whatever I say, you have to practice, that is true. And I must be reported either through mail or any other communication that whether you have got some benefit or not. Whether you have got some benefit or already existing benefit was looted along with this practice. I have to be clearly informed what is happening there. So you take a subject. You take a subject. Subject itself is very exhaustive. So take a lesson. Now, I have given you various exercises. Now I have quoted. But still, unless you just write down everything, you may not be knowing. Even I may not be knowing what I have told just before. So in that position, to understand things. Second, to have a casual memory without thinking that you are holding. For example, if you are having a fracture, you will be having a pain to hold this hand. If you are very normal and casual, are you feeling that you are carrying this hand or this neck is holding this head or the hip is holding this body? Are you having something? Because it is a component of the body, it is a compound structure in which it is casually holded, which will not give you some sort of uneasiness. So memory is also a part of your cognition. Your cognitive space can accommodate in its 0.1% all the published works which are there in the global libraries. That much you are having a space. That is the greatest thing. I told one lesson I conducted on confidence to 10th standard students. I told there are two initial steps for confidence. That your mind is all powerful, your brain is all powerful. These are all the first two steps of confidence. You can do but you are not doing is the essence of this confidence exercise. So you take a lesson. And just write the important points of the lesson in a paper.